Good evening. Welcome you all to the Department Discussion Series conducted by Department of Political Science and Public Policy. Our guest lecture titled Why Did Hillary Clinton Lose to Donald Trump? An analysis of the American election will be focused on the recently held American presidential election. Our guest speaker, Adam Barborich, is a Pennsylvania, USA. He has a first-class degree in political science from Penn State University, USA, and an MA in Buddhist philosophy from Buddhist and Pali University. He served for 6 years as a priest and area chairman for a Democratic Party in Center County, Pennsylvania. Currently, he is reading for a PhD in Buddhist philosophy at the University of Peradeniya. Without further ado, I would like to introduce Mr. Adam Barborich to deliver his speech.
All right, first I'd like to thank everybody here at the University of Colombo, especially the Political Science Department, for inviting me. Usually I do not sit and speak. I like to move around a little bit. We will do that afterward. Today, though, actually we had so many different questions and so many topics to touch on that I'm partially going to read. Otherwise, I have notes here that I'm also taking. So I'm going to improv a little bit on this. Then hopefully I want to get through this fairly quick and then we have time to wrap a little bit and we can have question and answer. All right. So for now, let's get to it. Some of you, I assume, here would be political scientists. I know my friend Elias is. One unfortunate tendency we have is a desire to attribute effects to causes. That's a little more difficult than it seems right off the bat. That's a philosophical discussion. So right away, if you're coming here and you're looking for one particular reason why Donald Trump was able to defeat Secretary Clinton in the presidential election, you're going to be in trouble, because it's like the Buddhist theory, Paticca-samuppada. There's a lot of conditions, a lot of causes, things all come together. And actually a lot of this, as we will see in my analysis, a lot of these causes were already laid out in advance. Actually, even though we had seen that Hillary was very favored to win the election, there were a lot of things that actually structurally were set against her. This was not going to be an easy race for any Democrat to win in this year. But we'll get to that there. I will state unequivocally, though, Clinton's defeat had nothing to do with Bernie Sanders, nothing to do with WikiLeaks, nothing to do with the FBI, nothing to do with Russia, not much to do with racism or sexism, being endemic throughout the entire country. Those are relatively controversial among some people, but I've been around this enough to know that isn't what caused it. And we'll try to address them all here in a relatively good order. Like I said, I'm trying to work through this in some kind of order so we're not here all day. First problem, like I said, I just alluded to, was the structural problem. This was going to be a difficult year for a Democrat to win, period, no matter who was running. Actually, I had predicted this back when Trump was, we were hoping he wouldn't go very far in the primaries for the Republican primary, but actually the odds-on favorites to take the Republican nomination were Jeb Bush, maybe Marco Rubio. A Bush-Kasich, Rubio-Kasich ticket would have been extremely dangerous to the Democratic Party anyways. It is likely we would have lost. This is because actually it's hard for any party to sustain 3 consecutive terms. Usually if you have a 2-term president from one party, you will have a switch in the next election. Demographic edge, a lot was made about this with the demographic edge that President Obama had actually put together. A lot of young people, a lot of women, the various minority communities. But President Obama is not your average Democrat. Also, actually, on a structural level, President Obama stayed very much out of the party and had a parallel structure for funding and campaigning. So to some extent, he was out for himself more than the party. I can't blame him on that. I mean, the man had to do what he had to do, and he was a very transformative president, and actually probably wouldn't have even been there minus the recession happening in 08. So he had a lot to work with on his plate anyway. But it is difficult for any party to retain power for more than two terms. Those demographics, actually, this was funny, because actually this is something that was analyzed to death in the media, that voter turnout was historically low, especially among these demographics. Actually, that is 100% not true. Voter turnout actually trailed only slightly behind 2012. Now, it may be, this is still coming in, the data is still coming in on this, so we're not sure. It may be that some of President Obama's demographics were low. That I actually think probably did occur, but I don't think it was significant. And the voter turnout would have been higher because Trump had actually pulled a lot of new voters into the process. Like I said, we don't have the numbers to really make definitive statements on that yet, but it seems plausible to me. And so the first reason we have is this structural systemic difficulties. Number two was our demographics. Our demographics we depended a little bit too much on. Third most important reason I have listed that we're probably going to spend the most time on is that the Democratic Party for years, this is something I've grown up with. This has been around since I was this tall. Democratic Party for years has neglected class and culture-based politics. And that is the thing you'll get, especially here, you get a lot of unreconstructed Marxists or wannabe Marxists that are going to talk about, oh my God, you know, class politics, this, that, and the other thing. Class and culture are synonymous, especially in the United States, but pretty much around the world. So we're not going to go into a neo-Marxian type theory on this. I can if you want, but basically, it was as much a cultural problem as a class problem. Although I do believe the approaches should be class-oriented, but we will get at that. Fourth reason I have, main reason, these are the main causes, once again, that we are dealing with immediately. I will get to the conditional factors a little later on. The status quo economy was good. Obama had been improving it. It was not great. Slow and steady wins the race, but slow and steady is often not appealing to the great majority of voters. So this is what we add. It's very hard, you can say, the nation as a whole, we're slowly but surely coming along. But like the great late great Tip O'Neill said, all politics at the end of the day is local. So if I'm not seeing it in my town, it's cold comfort for me to see 1-2% growth every year for the United States as a whole. Very importantly, again, a structural factor, is that Republican turnout was going to be high. The reason for this especially is because there were Supreme Court seats on the table. We actually have one vacancy already. Three of our judges are in their late 70s, early 80s. So it may come time, very shortly, the next president could conceivably have three picks without too much difficulty. Supreme Court turns out values voters. This is another cultural issue that, again, we'll get to. But so the religious right, but even, and everybody wants to talk about the religious right as if they are the main drivers. Actually, the United States is a very moral nation. It is a very religious nation. So it's unfair to actually lump the majority of values voter in with a very crazy evangelical far-right type movement. But it happens all the time. But these people that have moral concerns were going to turn out this year. Unlike in 2012, they were not motivated without Supreme Court justices on the table, without things like that. They were less than motivated to come out for Mitt Romney. But this year, be it Trump, be it Bush, be it anybody, as we see, they were going to turn out. So this was another factor that right from the beginning, we were kind of up against it a little bit more than people would have thought. Now we'll get into the candidate herself. Actually, Hillary Clinton is no Bill Clinton. That's the best thing I can say about that. I do not think she was a bad candidate, though. Actually, what we had was, she has really spent 25 years being totally character assassination from the other side. And I remember this because I was a kid, you know, I was a young teenager when Bill Clinton came into office. And his wife came in very idealistic, very pious Methodist woman, and she really wanted to get on board, help the country, this, that, and the other thing. They started right away on her, and they started on their daughter. And I mean, it was very ugly, but very effective. So they've actually tarred this woman for so many years that eventually people think, well, if you have this many accusations, there must be a little something to it. And this was a problem. Actually, we had a problem then with the Sanders voters enforced this narrative, which was not good for party unity. But again, I do not think actually Hillary's weakness as a candidate was a major factor. Hillary's weakness as a campaigner, in this case, is far more likely to be a big cause. Actually, the problem is, and I've only actually seen this work in one race, and that was the last Sri Lankan presidential race. And we all know about the foreign money and things on that. But actually, you don't win campaigns running against someone or something. You run for someone or something, the people. You run for ideas. You need an aspirational campaign. What Hillary Clinton did not do was run an aspirational campaign. She ran against Donald Trump. Like I said, you don't win running against things. And actually, this served to exacerbate some of the cultural divisions in that by pointing to... the interesting thing about Trump, nobody understands. Now, this is true also in America, but it is especially true here in foreign countries. Because where do we hear about Trump? It's media coverage. How many of you have actually sat and listened to Donald Trump speak at a rally the whole way through? Very few. That was the mistake a lot of people were making. This man talks a lot, for one thing. And he says some galactically stupid things. But the media will pull out that one soundbite, and they will not listen to the other 3 hours that this man is talking about and making America great again. This is an aspirational campaign. This is something Hillary Clinton did not run. You may disagree with Donald Trump, as I do vehemently, but the fact is he ran an aspirational campaign. He was running for something, not against everything. Now, here we get into the whole point. Something I want to dismiss, but I don't want to dismiss too lightly, is, you know, the structural racism, sexism in the electorate. It's real. I mean, we can't deny it. On the other hand, I do not believe that is what played the major part. And actually, by Hillary Clinton concentrating on this, again, running against Donald Trump and running against the people voting for him, by emphasizing that this is purely racially motivated, or primarily racially motivated, or primarily motivated by sexism, by bigotry, by anti-religious sentiments, any of this actually was very counterproductive. Because now, while this was a part, it's a small part. And actually, there's been a lot of racist dog whistling in US elections for as long as I can remember, but especially with the advent of the Southern strategy in the late 60s, the Republican Party has run on racist dog whistles forever. The only thing Donald Trump did was put them in more overt language, let's say. And this is a fact, though, but when you run on that, you can bring up these issues, and they should be brought up and they should be addressed. Racism, sexism is a problem. But when you run your campaign only against these ideas, and you tar every voter with that same brush, what you do is alienate the other side. It's like I said, actually it's very simple. Let's say I'm voting for president of University of Colombo, and then you are my electorate, but you are all racist, ignorant, bigots, stupid, you dress funny, you talk funny, please vote for me tomorrow. It doesn't work, does it? Now, you don't want to vote for me when I'm sitting there calling you names. Same thing. Nobody wanted to vote for Hillary when she's sitting there calling you names. And this is a problem I've dealt with a long time. Like I said, as we get into my background, you'll see this. All right. And this shift toward labeling the other side as ignorant, superstitious, racist, sexist, everything that is bad about America, this is something that actually came about because of our shift toward identity politics. And this is something that, like I said, has been a long time coming. There's been a lot of people, we've talked about this forever. When I sat as precinct and area chair, I fought on this all the time. We've had a big problem as we shifted toward an identity coalition. And identity politics in and of themselves, nothing wrong with it. I mean, you can make it work on occasion. The problem is that's when it's all you have, you get into trouble. And this really goes back to the late 70s. Actually, there's a parallel also in Britain. This is the Reagan-Thatcher era. So there were some very profound systemic motivators to this. And the working classes, as we began to deindustrialize. Now, one thing people have to understand, especially in the United States of America, because this is always funny, when you're sitting here, and then you talk about how Americans are in great poverty. Poverty is a very relative concept. Because compared to some of what we would see here or in India or China, anywhere in the developing world, Americans are not poor by any means. But the American situation was very much shaped by the post-war period. In that after the World Wars, the developing nations were, for the most part, undeveloped comparatively. Europe and the developed world was devastated by the war. America was the only one that was left to produce. So our factories produced for the world. And actually with the Marshall Plan in Europe, which you should all know about, the Marshall Plan, we rebuilt Europe so we'd have somebody to trade with. We rebuilt Japan so that we would have people to trade with. Because our industry was relatively unscathed, theirs was not. Well, needless to say, being the producer for the entire world, well, economically, it's a distortion. It's not something that was going to last forever. We thought it was, but it was not going to happen. The fact is, as Europe came online, they started to trade with us more. Now, they started making things. Japan became a superpower. I mean, industrially, it was absolutely fantastic. And now, actually, we're seeing more of this now as China, as India comes online. As globalization takes hold, these things are accelerating. But the trends were already there in the late 70s, early 80s. We weren't on top anymore. Now we had to compete. And this is why all of a sudden you really saw the Thatcherite movement in Britain, the Reagan movement in the United States, is it was part of this structural readjustment. And the working classes were really left behind on this. If this gets bothersome, let me know, I'll just put it aside. But the working classes were really left behind. And you notice too, I'm not talking about white working class, black working class, Latino working class. I'm talking about the working class as a whole. There is a definition to be made on occasion. Generally, I'm staying away from that division. If I single out that I'm talking about the white working class, that's who I'm talking about. If I say the working class, do not assume that that is only solely relegated to the white working class. But the problem was, at that time, as factories started to close, as labor unions started to lose power in the 1980s, the Democratic Party, to stay relevant, really had to shift more toward an identity-style politics. What we kept, what was keeping us in power, was a shift more towards ethnic voting. We kept women on board. We brought in more minorities to the fold. And because the Republicans had basically written them off, this was a decent strategy for us. And we should not leave these people disenfranchised. We want them on board. But the fact is, as we started to shift toward building these coalitions, we shifted away from what had been our traditional strong points. Our traditional strong points were labor issues, equality, economic opportunity. This was what we built. This was our bread and butter as Democrats. This is what Franklin Roosevelt did with our New Deal. We were a labor party for the most part. But very conservative as well. The American working class, period, across color lines, is not ideological. It is not. It never has been. It will shift right, it will shift left. It will shift wherever its interests are met. And this has been seen throughout our history from the late 1800s on. The working class in America will move in the direction it moves. Because we're a very centrist country. This is the American exceptionalism. You hear a lot about American exceptionalism. Few people know that actually Stalin was one of the people behind this term, that America is exceptional because it is beyond the Marxian process of history. That there's absolutely, America never went through that. It never went through the same class dynamics. It never went through the aristocracy, the feudalism, the capitalism. America had land out west. It was an exceptional nation. The left did not develop in the same way, neither did the right. So this exceptionalism has always meant that America is essentially a centrist nation. What that means is actually both parties, for the longest time, and even now to an extent, are centrist parties. We don't have a far left, we don't have a far right. Well, we do, but they're fringe. But the parties that represent them are all centrist, either center left, as the Democrats, which actually anymore, center right. The Overton window has moved a lot to the right. But so we had a big tent. So you would have Marxist idealists, former SWP guys, socialists, and things like that were also in the Democratic Party. But then you also had trade unionists who otherwise were very conservative, very religious, very normal bourgeois values. So it was a big tent, but the Democratic Party was always the party of the worker, the people. Actually, my great-grandmother once told me, as a youngster, she said, whatever you do, never vote for a Republican or buy a Ford automobile. And I said, why? She said, because they both do nothing but take money out of your pocket. Because the automobile, you're always fixing. The Republicans, they're always robbing you. So, you know, that was the way we were taught. This was a working man's party. The Democrats were for the poor. Republicans were for the rich. And with few exceptions, that was pretty much the case. Although politics were a lot more centrally oriented. There were Republicans that were quite liberal economically, and there were Democrats that were quite conservative in other ways. So it was very much a centrist type movement. And the other reason why I want to get away from the race thing is too, is because when we look at the working class as a whole, we just have to look at the numbers. Actually, Hillary Clinton, compared to 2012, Asian voters, 11% more went for Trump than in 2012. Black voters, well, it was they got 8% of the black vote compared to 3, so it was 5 or 6 points difference compared to 2012. Yeah, so that actually it had changed by 3-4%. Latinos, Hispanics, 30% turnout. And actually this is indicative of a trend if you look at it. This is something, again, where the Democratic Party made a very foolish assumption. They assumed that since Latin voters are also minorities, also people of color, that they are also going to join into the liberal identity coalition. What they neglected to realize is these are also very traditional, very Catholic groups. And there is, and there appears to be, across elections, about 30% of the Hispanic vote, Latino vote, tends to actually go conservative. So, I mean, this is not unheard of.
So, and actually,
I still don't. All right. That's still why we actually had a problem. Hillary Clinton did not just lose the white working class. Hillary Clinton lost the working class. And it is through no fault of Hillary Clinton, other than the fact she didn't run a great campaign. It is the fault of our party as Democrats. This is something, as again, I've been saying forever. I grew up in this environment. My area, very poor, very industrial, coal mining, union supporting, very solid, strong, Democratic stronghold for years. It no longer is. But actually, this is where it started happening. We had steel in Pennsylvania. We had mines in Pennsylvania. We had the railroads. Everything was interdependent. We had an industrial economy that in the late 70s, early 80s began to fall apart. First, steel went. When you don't have steel, you don't need coal. So when you don't need coal, the coal mines go. When you don't need coal, you don't need railroads to ship the coal. So then the railroads go. So we actually had a huge downturn in my state right around late 70s, early 80s. And people were real in trouble with this. A lot of them were able to switch to the public sector. So it was still decent. We still had other factories. There were still options. And actually, the biggest thing, one reason that's very much neglected among people is union density. Because unions involve people in the political struggle, they get used, they learn how to vote. Civil society, period, is like this. As unions have declined, nothing is actually, for statistical guys in here, nothing is a better indicator of which way you will vote than union membership. Because you will discuss these, and you do have a stake in it. So you're brought into the system. You're not an individual out there trying to make a decision. You actually are getting input. You're saying, this is going to affect me this way or that way. So actually, your union density is one of your big motivators for how people will vote. And it usually goes to the left, obviously. Well, unions started to get, they were gutted out in the 80s. Ronald Reagan really did a number on it. So this is where we lost a lot of it. And people were still fighting, trying to get through this. And these were people that were not necessarily, they were not intellectuals. They're people actually you would probably look down upon because they're undereducated. But they're smarter than a lot of you would think. But they're undereducated. They work hard. They're a little bit crude. Many of them, their parents or their grandparents were immigrants. They worked hard. Their families, many of them, like mine, actually came over, went through a depression, then went through two wars. Most of these men were also military men. During the Cold War, we had a rather large armed forces. So we had a lot of people that were veterans, many of whom had fought, other ones who had just served. We had a draft. These people had done everything they were supposed to do. They didn't break the rules. They played by the rules. They worked hard. They put their kids through school because they didn't have school. They worked, they wanted that piece of the pie, the American dream. And some of them, thankfully, because of strong unions and because of our post-war position, people were able to climb out of poverty, give their kids a better life. So this was very important, and this is what these people felt. And like I said, I was there. This is the family I grew up in. And in the 80s, things started to go wrong. All of a sudden, people were losing jobs. And where were they going? They were going overseas. And where were we sitting there? The unions all of a sudden came under attack. So then people were out on the picket lines. They were fighting to keep their spot. And all of a sudden, they just kept getting rolled back. And it kept getting worse. Finally, and actually what really killed us, that people don't put it together, was when the Soviet Union collapsed. Because now everything changed. Because before, we had been the sole producer of the world. Then all of a sudden, Europe, Japan, everybody caught up. Now all of a sudden, when the Soviets fell apart, you have an entire second world that's also starting to develop. Then you have the third world developing. This is where globalization came in. And it's something, our political process, we kicked this into motion. And it's a good thing. It's lifted people out of poverty. It's kept the world stable. It's not a bad thing. But to a guy that's down here, that saw his standards rise, was doing better for his kid, all of a sudden to get knocked back down, it's hard for people to take. And actually, this is the big thing, too. If you want to go back to where all this really, really caught hold, you go to the late 80s, early 90s. Late 80s, 1988. How many of you have heard of Jesse Jackson? Huh? How many of you have heard of Bernie Sanders? Yeah. Bernie Sanders, socialist, right? No. Bernie Sanders is to the right of Jesse Jackson in 1988. Jesse Jackson was more of a socialist than Bernie Sanders. To say that Bernie Sanders is some new face of the left, that we're going to have a socialist revolution, is complete nonsense. Jesse Jackson was running in 1988, took 30% of the Democratic vote in 1988. Now, this was a black man well before Obama, who for that reason alone probably wasn't going to get in. This guy performed. White people voted for Jesse Jackson. That was because this economic problem was going on. 92. Everybody forgets the proto-Trump, a man named Ross Perot, took 19% of the popular vote in the election after he dropped out. It was an absolutely bizarre campaign because Perot actually had a very good chance of winning this thing. And then all of a sudden he dropped out. His vice president was half crazy. It was really something. I don't think he wanted to be president, much like Donald Trump, but he was smart enough to be able to find himself a way out. And that's what, during this time, presidentially we were getting killed. Ronald Reagan was destroying us. I mean, we couldn't win elections to save our life. We still had the House of Representatives. We had it for 40 years. 1994, that changed too. Because all of a sudden a fellow named Newt Gingrich came out with a contract for America. And this is when people started to jump. First they jumped for Perot. Lifelong Democrats were sitting there and they were saying, okay, you know, I'm tired of losing. It was a rough race. Bill Clinton was not exactly what everybody wanted, although he came to be something we really liked. But he was triangulating, new Democrat. So people were kind of jumping toward an alternative to push the Democratic Party to recognize what was going on. They did. Finally, 1994, the Republicans came out with, like I said, the contract with America. They actually came out and said, we're going to do this. Please vote for us. And to tell you the absolute truth, the Republicans did follow through to the best of their ability. So they came out actually talking to the people and saying, we're going to at least try to address this. I don't believe their policy solutions were any good. They actually exacerbated the problem, but they came out and gave an alternative. Hence, they won. After that, we were in big trouble. And really, since then, it's been pretty much a Republican hegemon. We switch back and forth a few times, but like I said, the window has moved so far to the right that the Democrats are a very center-right party. What we used to say, a lot of my friends back home, too, we'd always say about that, was Bill Clinton was the best Republican president we've ever had. Yeah, because in 1980, Bill Clinton would have been a Republican. That's how he would have been classified. By 1992, he's a Democrat. Yeah, he was always identified as a Democrat the whole way through. But his policies in 1980 would have been on the far right of the party. Everything had moved so far that we actually had Republicans calling him Clinton's, you know, leftist, which was rather absurd. All right, so that's a lot of the historical background on why this was going. And actually, the Democratic Party had written off rural and working class whites, especially in building the identity coalition, but in general, had written off a lot of the working class. And when I say that, that's not to say that this was done haphazardly, I think. Because the Republicans wrote off the black vote. I mean, they do not expect to win it. Like I said, Trump actually overperformed because only 8% of black people voted for him. That's better than other guys were doing. They're not hoping, they're not going to get more than 10%. That's been that way for years. The black vote is going to break 90% for the Democratic Party. So the Republicans wrote it off. You don't campaign with people you don't have a chance of winning. Democrats self-identified this with the white working class. We don't have a chance of winning. But actually, as Clinton, as President Obama proved, there is a chance. And actually, we have been there before. People were too quick to write it off. Actually, a big problem with this is, like I said, cultural. It's a class problem as well. Class is difficult to deal with, though, especially in a global economy. Because to a great extent, you can't negotiate this so much with the voter. Because it's very hard to campaign on, you know, we had a really great run, but now China, India, these places are growing. We can't have what we used to have. We're going to have to take a little bit of a cut. And other people are going to be rising. You know, it's a moral duty. But that's not easy to sell people. Yeah, take a cut in pay. Take a cut in your standard of living. No, that isn't... People don't want to hear that. To an extent, it's kind of what we got to do. And actually, I think this is why you'll see a lot of austerity movements, especially in Europe right now. European Union countries pushing for austerity all the time. Why are they pushing for austerity? When actually, if you look at it policy-wise, it's often counterproductive. What they are doing, though, is slowly habituating the people to a lower standard of living than what they had. Get them used to austerity because it's going to come anyway. I actually believe that's the case for most of them. But our problem when we shifted to identity politics is we shifted away from class, which, like I said, is hard to actually win on. It's a capitalist world. We're going to have to get through and figure out the best we can. But what we also did in writing off class was we wrote off culture. And this is actually... This is the big mistake we made. Because now you have a very intellectual elite class making policy. And you actually have a lot of it is centered in the universities. University students, intellectuals are some of the biggest problem. I think that's probably everywhere, but here at least they don't listen to intellectuals, so you don't have to worry about screwing things up. But in America, it's some of the biggest problems. Because all of a sudden, we've transferred into this thing. As I said, the vast majority of the American people, all classes, creeds, colors, everything, we're very religious people. We're very moral people. So when you start looking at issues like abortion, and I'll tell you what, if you are very strongly pro, strongly anti, and you cannot make a legitimate argument on the other side, then you're not paying attention to that issue. Because it is very morally and philosophically complex. There is no easy answer, as with most of these cultural questions. There is no easy answer. And a lot of people on the left have made the mistake of saying that there is an easy answer. Well, of course. And they've also attacked. Again, the radical right, the religious right, brought a little bit of this on themselves because they're very loud. But when you start attacking the Christian religion, you're not only attacking them. Other people are taking that as an attack too. They're seeing their values on this. Promiscuity, divorce, all these issues, actually, the Republicans are absolutely horrible on these issues. That's every time they went after Bill Clinton for having an affair, they would turn out that all of them were also having affairs and, you know, were running with men and women and everything else. It was absolutely just a farce. But the Republican Party was the only party even talking about it. And these are issues people care about, as much as their economic class. They want to have a better economy too, but also when they see their kids falling into drugs, teen pregnancy, women running around, this, that, the other, they don't like that either. That's threatening. So obviously, these issues go together. And like I said, class is culture. Feminist, big problem with feminists that we had. And I like feminists, I am feminist. That's not a problem. But a big problem we had with feminists in this election in particular is that they assumed that the feminist vote would go to Hillary Clinton. At which, pretty good assumption to make, you would think. The problem is, women do not only identify as women. A trend you will actually see, again, that has gone over many elections, is single women tend to vote Democratic. Married women tend to vote Republican. Why? I don't know. But all of a sudden, when a woman is married, has some kids, then she's looking at education, maybe the social problems, starts to take on a little different perspective than when you're free and running wild and everything. I know marriage changed me a lot. And then also you have women of color. Black women, Hispanic women, Latino women, they all have different problems. And actually a lot of the feminist, well, we have a rivalry between second, third wave that's really going on right now. Some are saying fourth wave. But a lot of the real feminist ideological talk is very second wave, bourgeois, middle class, white ladies. And then, you know, they were convinced that this is a law. I thought it would be too. I really didn't predict it would go that way. But it did. When it broke, they were more surprised than me. Because this is what I said, we had gone too much on the identity side, not enough on class, and not enough on culture. A great number of women are very anti-abortion. Not every woman is pro-choice. Some are pro-choice legally, anti-abortion morally. You have a lot of different perspectives. And then you have people that are against it that might have one anyway, depending on their situation. That's the way people are, we're complicated. So, you can't deal with that. All right. But those are your main reasons. Like I said, you got class-based, you got structural problems. This was not a surprising election when it comes down to that. As for conditioning, you know, conditional factors, you'll hear a lot of nonsense. Neoliberalism. Number one, before you blame the election on neoliberalism, you have to tell me what neoliberalism is. And nobody tells me, because nobody really knows. It's a pejorative catch-all for everything. It can mean anything from capitalism to deregulation, privatization. It can be fascist autarky to anarchy. Neoliberalism is whatever you want to say. It's kind of like fascist became among the old style Marxists. Everybody who wasn't a Marxist is a fascist. The word has lost meaning. So neoliberalism is, it's a rather silly word and it's thrown around stupidly. Bernie Sanders. I voted for him, primaries, like the guy, very good. He did point out that some of this class-based politics, there really is still, there's a space for it in our political arena, we need it. But Bernie was not a good campaigner. He did not appeal to older voters, he did not appeal to women, he did not appeal to minorities. He appealed very much to the young, and to bourgeois middle class people. He wasn't appealing to a large enough sector of the population to really be relevant. And also, he refused to touch on these cultural issues. Although he got people to come on board with the class, all he kept on, Wall Street bankers, da da da. It was so repetitive that it was useless. I lost faith in Bernie fairly early because I knew he was going to tank fairly early. And his big thing, like I said, yeah, I'm different because I'm a socialist. No, you're more right-wing than Jesse Jackson. You're not a socialist. So actually, this is where we had a little bit of a problem. But I don't think he actually took away enough voters. I do think he contributed slightly to this demonization of Hillary Clinton. But really, I can't blame him too much for that either. I think she dropped the ball more than he did. But so Sanders is a very good bellwether. He can show us which way things are going. But as a candidate, he was very flawed and he was not really a threat. And I don't think that his minuscule percentage of voters that stayed home really did much on the election. Again, contributing factors. These are conditional factors. Neoliberalism and all that. These are conditional factors. They had some point. But none of these alone was going to shift this election. Even in combination, very hard to say that would have put them over the top. The WikiLeaks, same thing. Actually, WikiLeaks is another one. It's more perception than reality. You've all heard of WikiLeaks, right? How many of them have read the emails? Read them. They're actually just gossip. Actually, they've always been pretty much that. It's the type of gossip you would hear around any diplomatic or political circle. I worked on a lot of campaigns. When I'm running campaigns, I say nasty things in my emails about the other side. It's pretty common. I'll talk about all kinds of people. So these emails were not that damaging. And WikiLeaks, as far as the Russians leaking it, that's probably true. The Russians probably did have a part in that. But once again, since WikiLeaks was not so important, I doubt the Russians influenced the election that much. Number two, though, you have to expect that. It's a new world. If the Russians are able to influence elections, they will. And we influence elections quite a bit ourselves. We're well known for it. So I can't complain too much on that. The FBI issue was a little bit interesting. That was timing. I think that, of all the conditional factors, did play more of a part. But honestly, I don't think if it hadn't have happened that Hillary would have won on that either. So, I mean, that's what we're looking at. Basically, a perfect storm of things happened that put Trump in the White House. The factors played right. Like I said, take Supreme Court appointments off table. Religious voters stay home. Hillary wins easily. And actually, the Democratic Party would then be very complacent. Actually, the map would look a lot like 2012. Enthusiasm, if it had been up a little more, somebody other than Hillary might have turned it, might not have. But everything basically came together. But what we have is actually this very cultural dynamic that's behind the scenes. And that's why I said it's not limited to any race, color, creed, although these play a part. What you're seeing is a culture of urban, intellectual, elite versus rural, semi-urban, working class, conservative people. Bridging that gap is getting more difficult. And actually, the way the media is anymore, this is going to be the main challenge of parties going forward. It's because now I can tune in and I don't get to watch Walter Cronkite or Dan Rather on the CBS News and get a middle perspective. What I get is generally ideological, Fox News, MSNBC, CNN. I get an ideological look. Everything now is ideological. And actually for that, one thing you can look at is El Comandante, Fidel Castro, died recently. Now, I'm sure you've all read about this. But what you read is completely ideological. Castro was a bad guy. I mean, he was very ruthless, very repressive. But Castro was also a symbol. He was a symbol to the third world. He was a symbol to the colored people of the world. This man actually had good intention. He was not corrupt. A very uncorrupt dictator. Very rare to see. But Castro had a lot of good, a lot of bad. He was a man of his time. He is a man in some ways transcended his time. But when you look at the coverage, it is either he is wholly evil or he is wholly good. There's no middle. There's no. They act as if you can't be a dictator and do good things. Or as if you can't be a compassionate person and do some bad things. And that goes against the entire history of anything political. Because actually, if you look, old Indian kings and old Kandyan king, Rajasinghe. You know, he ground up the baby with a pestle and all the, you know, really horrific actions. But he was also a very cultured man, very learned man, you know, a very decent ruler too, actually. There's a lot to that. But you have these people, they had two very distinct sides. A king that could do something like that was also a king that would support culture. So that's the reality. The way we're living now in the bubbles, it's very ideological. And that's where we're getting into trouble. And actually, the more ideological we come and with post-materialist values as Democrats, the more trouble we're going to be in. Because we have to bridge this gap. We're not in a post-material society. And while we should be helping to be more inclusive as a society, we've got to address a lot more systemic issues than transgender bathrooms. We're getting into trouble on this. We actually have a problem where the bourgeois, middle class, Democratic Party cannot even talk to the working class Democratic Party. They do not speak the same language anymore. And that's something that's been coming a long time, and it's something as Democrats, we need to address in a matter. And that's what I have to say about that. So I'll take questions now. Otherwise, I'll be going on here forever.
Thank you very much, Mr. Barborich, for your enlightening views on the American presidential election. Now, the floor is open for the questions.
Interest is on issues of theory, because that's what political scientists, basically social scientists, are built upon. Now, with what has happened in the U.S. elections, can we ask you that are there theories, basically, which exist that could be used to explain what has happened? That's my first question, one in one. Now within that, you know, there is what we call the grounded theory. In the grounded theory, you work from below and identify variables that have what we call the interface, and based on those variables, you develop a new theory based on what is being seen. Now when you have the two, what in your opinion would you suggest? Work with an existing body of theories, or we build from the ground? The theory to explain what has happened in America. Because when you look at trend analysis for the past 2 years now, in 2015, I was here, the Sri Lanka election was somehow a surprise. In my country, where I come from, Nigeria, Same 2015, a sitting president lost the election. And it has never happened before. That's a trend. Now you go to Brexit. Brexit, the way it went and the way it was going, you would have expected that it would have been the other way around. And Cameron had to leave. Theresa May had to come in. Now you move to America this year, you see another trend. So when you look at those two cases are now never the same. You know, the African experience be different from Asia, and Europe different from America. But when you look at that connected to what I'm asking about theories, will you advise us to look for existing theories, or we build one on what has happened? Thank you.
Finally.
No way. Actually, this is one thing also I really want to make sure I don't do and other people should not do, is don't take Donald Trump as some extraordinary phenomenon. He's not. This strain of populism is something we've had for a long time. Like I said, actually Donald Trump's theories are not as insane as people would. I disagree with him profoundly, but we're probably looking at a George W. Bush sequel administration. You're not going to see any camps or any real craziness open up. A lot of that is because of the systems. A lot of that is because I don't think Trump actually wanted to be president. I think he liked the idea of it, but I didn't think he was going to win. And I don't think he did either. So actually what you're seeing, this is where it actually comes across with Brexit in the European theater. In the West, what you are seeing, in the long run, ties into globalization, which again, now we'll get into neoliberalism from this side. The Western countries are adjusting. There are structural adjustments going on. We simply, it is no longer economically efficient for us to have the factories and things we had before. It is much better to let the Chinese do it. It's cheaper. No, not always better, but generally cheaper. There is economic sense to globalization, is what I'm saying. We're going to have a hard time dealing with this, though, because of economic nationalism. And this is what you're seeing in Europe, too. Keep the immigrants out. Keep wages high. Protect us. You're seeing more protection. This is direct result of globalization. So this is what we're going to actually have. And actually, a lot of you would have heard probably about this universal basic income. Universal basic income is one of the biggest scams you will ever see coming. This is actually something I really am scared of, this theory. Because what is going on, they're saying now in the West, obviously, we're not going to have jobs for everybody because they're all coming to you. So now we don't have jobs. What are we going to have our people do? Oh, we'll just give them money. We'll give them a universal basic income. Then they can do whatever. They can be entrepreneurs. They can be this, that, and the other thing. But when you look deeper into that theory, we're giving you money to consume the things that aren't produced here anymore to keep the wheels rolling. This is where economically, especially political economy, we're going to need a new theory, because these theories are not going anywhere anymore. They are at the end of their life. I'm not saying that because I want it to be true. I'm saying this is true. When you actually have to start considering giving people money just to keep the same system going, you're in trouble. Because at least before, the capitalists would say, I'm giving you a wage so you produce something. So then we're making things good. Now it's like, don't even bother producing. Just actually buy it. And actually, now, it's good for countries here, where things will grow. But again, where does this end up in the long run? Because what's actually going on is you're almost creating a global caste system. You're going to have a consuming class that fuels the economy. The producers are going to be the cheapest possible. They're going to be kept there, slowly developed. And the rich are going to get richer, and the poor is going to get poorer. So actually, we're coming to a real end. So if I had the theory that was going to fix it, if I had the new theory, I wouldn't be sitting here. I'd be sitting in Harvard or with Donald Trump. We'd be having dinner or something right now. I wouldn't be in Colombo. So I don't know what the new theory is going to be. But something is going to actually have to come up. That's an absolute fact. But as far as analyzing where this election went, it's not extraordinary. It really flows into just regular theory. Like I said, your biggest problem was a structural one. Normally, after 8 years of one party having rule, we switch. Yeah, that's just the way it goes. The states broke pretty much as they would have been expected. The only difference was the Rust Belt states. Even then, it was a rather small margin of victory. But as far as in the overall climate, right-wing, conservatives, protectionist moves are very, very strong throughout the Western world right now. There's a resurgent sense of nationalism. Not popular nationalism as much as economic, but it is there. So, I mean, that's our theories pretty much address that issue. The new theory on where we're going to go, well, you got me. Hopefully something will come up. We'll let the market decide.
With the president's ready for the human president as their commander in chief, would that have been effective?
As I said, any systemic racism, sexism is always a factor. But no, America would. If you would have asked me in 2008, I would have picked that America would elect a woman before a black guy. And you know, now we did both. So that part I don't think. Now Hillary Clinton herself, like I said, unfortunately, as the first woman candidate, has been in the public eye a long time. And like I said, they tore this woman apart. They accused her of literally almost everything for years.
How much
did
baggage
play? Baggage played a big part.
If she was like an outsider, maybe just like an outsider, what would that have been?
Much better. Yeah, this was the year of the outsider on that. And this is actually a real shame. Hillary Clinton probably, as you would have heard a lot of analysis, was probably the most qualified candidate you'd ever see. And competent. Very technocratic, you know. She didn't have charisma, but she would have been a very interesting president to watch. Because how far does competence versus leadership get you? She never came across as the greatest leader. And like I said, she had 25 years. The fact that she was in the race shows how competent she is. Because literally, actually in 2008, when we were even closer to the Clinton years, I picked Obama to beat her in the primary simply because I didn't think Hillary could win an election. This time she could have, but she didn't run the campaign. In that sense too, not so much only her being an insider, it was what she learned to do as an insider. Hillary Clinton ran a very cautious campaign. Hillary Clinton actually, when she came as first lady, her husband put her in charge of healthcare. We're gonna figure this out. We're gonna give everybody universal healthcare. Again, 1992. Bernie Sanders, such a new thing. No, this is 1992. We've been fighting this for a long time. But she went out and she really pushed hard. And that's what she got killed for. So she learned a very valuable lesson to be cautious. Don't put yourself out there all at once. Because she got beat down. And I think she absorbed that lesson maybe a little too well for this election cycle.
My question is basically about this ideology and economy, because you talked about both of these things. Basically, I think, you know, we talked about the move to the cultural side in the American politics, but when we analyze it, you can see, actually, you also mentioned certain, you know, this cultural move happened under certain economic, political economic circumstances. And I can't understand the isolation about the word neoliberalism, but right? I think if we completely ignore that word, we can still think about the significant change in the significant shift towards more privatization, kind of more, you know, the neoclassical kind of economic theories, you know, since the 1970s. and also you have the globalization, talk about that also. So I think there is a kind of significant political economic shift under Reagan, Thatcher era since 1980s. So we can completely ignore the word neoliberalism, but we can't completely ignore this historical change, what happened in 1980s. And when you explain the dynamics of this cultural context also, there shouldn't be focus our attention on the political economic factors under which this kind of political move was possible.
Actually, there's a lot to it. Number one, I don't say ignore the system neoliberalism. I say ignore the word, because the word has no meaning anymore. You can say neoliberalism be referring to privatization, deregulation, or you can be talking about the overall global economy. It means whatever people want it to mean. I don't like the word. Actually, though, what the shift in the 1980s, late 70s, 1980s, was very profound. That's what I said. These are impacts you can't get away from. Because this is why I said Europe and Japan, the other countries were also developing. We had competition. It was no longer the United States as the sole economic power. And now, all of a sudden, with globalization, it's really, how much different is it than when the Europeans and the Japanese came online too? Now you have India, you have China, you have other countries coming online, Southeast Asian tigers. So now with globalization, again, it's not neoliberalism, that's globalization. So we actually have this global economy problem, then we have deregulation, privatization, which are domestic problems. When you start throwing it all together, what happens is the analysis gets sloppy. So that's why I don't like that part of it. But yeah, the political and economic and the political economy is extremely important to what's going on here. Because this is why people feel threatened. And this is why I say, you see this right-wing, nationalist, protectionist movement coming across the world, because people are trying to protect themselves from the influences of globalization. They're worried. They're worried, especially economically. The problem is, I'm gonna bet you're on the left. But I don't know. But the problem is, what we've had, in this sense, the left has been the obverse of the right. They've been on the same coin. What we're really dealing with, especially in Western cultures, is something, it's not purely, the Marxian theory is everything comes from class struggle. Everything comes, it all comes down to economics eventually. That is not exactly true. The bigger problem we have philosophically is now that we move to a very materialist direction. Nietzsche. We've moved away. We killed God. God is dead. It was this religious, spiritual disruption of value. And actually you see it here in Buddhism too. This Protestant Buddhism from Colonel Alcott. You know, the Americans came here. We taught you about your own. And we actually did this, the British mostly. Blame them for most things. With Islam, with Hinduism, with Buddhism, we all had all these revivals in the late 1800s, early 1900s. These revivals were because British Orientalists were not happy with the way they were practicing their religion. Said, no, put all that superstitious stuff aside, come here, go to the text, learn this, do the Pali. They did it with the Islamic people too. The Muslim states were very fairly liberal. Then all of a sudden they went there, your religion says you should do this, go back to the book, go back to the book, go back to the prophet. Then when they go back to the prophet and they go back to the fundamentals, they're a fundamentalist. it's a rather silly outcome, but this is what happened. And this was a result in the West. West was grappling with spiritual issues. It was an issue where everything was very materialistic. And this is the way we still are. And this is why I say, this is Marxist theory, but also capitalist theory, that everything is ultimately material. The forces of history, everything is ultimately material. So you have this, everything is going to work, the god of the market. I mean, the capitalists are just as deterministic as the Marxists at the end of the day.
Let me ask another question.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying that the market, the economy is the final economic system. But, the biggest problem is why culture and nation or ethnicity or kind of making America the great nation became the solution for this, political economic kind of situation.
This is where I'm going with that. Because now we had, the other thing is religion, spirituality is based in the community. It is not an individual practice. Nobody, if you all of a sudden say, I believe whatever, it's not a religion unless you have a lot of followers with you. You have things. Now, this is what happened. This is somewhat economic. What you're getting, the way this is going, this is also, like I said, it's a cultural, spiritual disruption because families have fallen apart. People are becoming socially atomized. This is where I said, actually, I touched on this with unions. But it's broader than that. It's actually what we used to call civil society. And civil society, a big part in America, and this is where the left gets in trouble attacking religion, a big part of civil society in America, the civil rights movement, is in the churches. America is a very religious country. My town, a lot of towns in Pennsylvania, the church was the center of the town. Everything else was built around it. So you would go there, that is where your community got together. This is where people talk. This is where people plan. Those are gone. Now all of a sudden the work weeks have gone on with competition due to globalized labor. You have to do more with less. So first, women went to work. Women went to work, the families helped. Yeah, then all of a sudden everybody went to work and worked harder and longer. Then things suffered even more. You used to be able to, like I said, when I was a kid growing up, everybody went to church on Sunday, so you met your neighbors there. But then, most of the people were members of the union, so they had union meetings every month. Then we had a democratic club where people would shoot billiards, they would have drinks, they would do that. People would go to the club, and they would meet with their neighbors, and people were discussing things. All of a sudden, now, you don't see it anymore. It's going down. Now everybody's working so hard, so long, just to keep their head above water, they don't have time. These extra things. So that's what I'm saying. Actually, the civil society, when it fell apart, you go to a union meeting, if we're all in a union, we're steel workers or something, we're going to go have a meeting. We might disagree, but we're going to talk these issues out. And we're going to try and come to some consensus of what is good for us politically. Without that, you're on your own. Now you have to decide what you're going to decide. And somebody like Trump can give you a promise. And there's nobody there to hell. Somebody like Hillary can give samples. You're kind of on your own. Figure it out. And really, once again, you're working so hard. How many people have time to sit there and do detailed policy analysis? This was a problem with Hillary, too. She was very policy-oriented. Very, very bright. But she talked about, policy. She couldn't explain it in simple language. It was very complex. People don't like complexity anymore. So actually, that's what you're getting at. And this is why I say it's a profound shift that there's a lot of economic factors to it, but it's not wholly economic. It's actually a philosophical, it's a Weltanschauung. It's your worldview has changed. And actually, you're starting to see it here. Interestingly, our sister-in-law. When I was growing up, they called us latchkey kids when our mothers went to work. Because they would leave the key there and we would let ourselves in, we would make our own food. So we kind of ended up raising ourselves. And this was a horrible social phenomenon, horrible problem that was going on. And like I said, this late 70s, early 80s. Now all of a sudden in Sri Lanka, sister-in-law goes to work, husband goes to work. And I said, now the kids are becoming latchkey kids. It's happening here too. So this is partially an economic dislocation. This is also partially just a cultural dislocation. We don't have the same priorities. Families are getting smaller, 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 and people are becoming more individualized. Individualism is not always, especially rampant American individualism, not always the best way to build a political system. So I think there's a lot to it.
Yeah. I think I could describe it. Some people call neoliberalism.
Yeah, like I said, you can call almost anything neoliberalism after a while.
The thing is, neoliberalism has become such an amorphous term, shows that people have a difficulty in actually grasping what is happening under free market economy.
Yeah.
Right? I think maybe we may not like the term because it has become so diffusive and, you know, making us understand what's going on. But it shows that this kind of atomization is understood by the theorists. One major effect of the economy of the rising, right? So now I thought in the case of the states you are describing, United States, well, for one thing, this class factor you equate with the culture. If you are people here, then class, Marx is there, right? You in with, right? But the cultural factor also, you will find usage in like neo-Marxists, right? I don't know what you mean by the kind of theories. But Marxism has developed an understanding to incorporate the cultural change also.
Yeah.
So if
I actually put myself closer to the Marxist side than
yes. If you're looking for theories, you could bring in Gramsci and later.
These
are my yes. So what I'm thinking about is now sometime back, Thomas Piketty wrote a book, right? Titled The Return of the Capital, right? He explained the fact that the gap in Western societies between the richest and the poorest was widening, so that the middle class was also being undermined in like a position. So I was surprised to hear you referring to class, but we did not discuss what about the super rich capitalist class in the US. Because that is where the analysis of neoliberalism will help in a way, because there is such an amassing of wealth in the states as well as in other countries. They are not only the poorest people, but even the middle classes were feeling that they were kind of alienated from the social system, the economic system, right? So when we take that into consideration, I'm really surprised that with all the intellectuals who are there in the democratic camp, right? Why couldn't they fathom what was happening, right? And if Obama could be a second term in America on the basis of identity politics and so on, why couldn't the pundits in the, you know, the Hillary Clinton setup could understand what was happening, you know, the carpet being kind of pulled under their feet, like as it were? I'm surprised. Of course, now with the benefit of hindsight, we can analyze what happened. What happened with it? Why couldn't we understand that this kind of nationalist sentiments were rising as you were describing the religious basis and so on? Is it simply because of, you know, the worldwide class only? Or is there something larger happening in American society?
Actually, now this again, because this is another one. Now we're going to the global inequality. Inequality, inequality, inequality. This is a mantra almost on the left among certain people. And it's an issue that needs to be addressed. But again, I don't think it's actually that much of an influencing factor. Because now what we're talking about, like the very top global 1%, top money makers, the amount of money they have to any of us is really an abstraction. You can't even call. The political sentiment is at a much more local level, where, like I said, it's not so much. Any people are very tolerant of people living, the elites living with all this abstract, huge amounts of money. They don't care, as long as their standard of living is going up. The problem is, their standard of living is going down. Then when they see these big guys on top and that they're increasing, that breeds resentment, but it's not so much the driver. The driver isn't like take from them, bring it down. That's what I said. That's actually not the biggest thing. You could let them still have magnitudes more money as long as the trajectory is going upward. That's what you see. And this is where...
That's where the state comes in, right?
Yeah.
The state has it already paid.
Yes, it does. But this is where, again, it's not so much an economically determinist argument.
this is where I have problems, because actually this is where we got into this problem. Because when we shifted, actually I like the Marxist a lot better because the Marxists are coherent. Where we shifted to was with this liberal bourgeois Democrat was that the problem is the welfare state. The social Democrats are the damn problem. Because they're the ones that said we can fix every problem by throwing money at it. We can redistribute our way out of difficulty. And that's why I said, actually, what people are going through, especially the working classes in Western countries, is not an economic crisis. It's an existential crisis. They're actually seeing their entire worldview is being ripped up by the roots. This is why people are uneasy. And that's why I said, your average working class poor person in America may not read all the same books we read, but they're not stupid people. You can, they can tell as well as you. And this is actually CNN. After the election, went to Youngstown, Ohio, because the class was the mythical white working class voter. We have to find out, why did these people go for Trump? So this reporter from CNN, he got in the car and he went down the I-80 corridor. It was like Conrad. It was like going into the heart of darkness, going up the river, not knowing what's going on. Oh my God, you know, Marlowe's narrating this tale. He goes to a bar in Youngstown, which now is a town I worked a lot in. Youngstown, very steel city, very old working class. He goes in there and he starts talking and he's looking for this savage white working class voter, this tribe. So he finds one of them and he says, they start talking, it's like, why did you vote for Trump? Jobs, this, that. Very, very banal answers. Just like you would give for any kind of, I thought, you know, maybe we'd get a little more jobs here, there, this, that, and the other. So the reporter, now he's sitting there for CNN, nobody wants to watch people talking about, I thought maybe this economical, he wants a little juice, you know? So, what about the wall? We gonna build the wall? And the guy's like, the white working class voter, the ignorant, bigoted, savage, primordial, seething racism, looks at him and he says, I don't think he meant he was actually gonna build a brick and mortar wall. I think he meant we're just gonna try and secure the borders. I don't think he's actually gonna build it. And the reporter is stunned because he couldn't imagine that these people did not actually believe Donald Trump was gonna go down there and start building a great wall of America. It wasn't gonna happen. So I think that's where you get some of this. It's not an economic problem so much. The white working class voters and the working class in general know Trump's not gonna be able to deliver on everything, or even most of what he was talking about. What they're trying to do though, they're looking at something, they're looking at a global trend, and they're looking at a trend that's been going on for 40 years. We've been on this downhill slide. Like I said, I grew up in this. From the time I've been growing up, I've just watched us get beat down, worse and worse and worse. Every year, we're just sliding down. So actually, it wasn't like, don't avail yourself of the notion that all of a sudden the white working class people and the working classes in general saw Donald Trump as a savior. Now, they know we're probably still going to be going down. But at least this guy's talking to us. At least this guy might shake it up a little. He might try something different. And that's what I said. That is not something, if it was drawn purely on economic policy, Obama's done an excellent job since the recession. If a rational economic homo economicus would have voted, we would have had Hillary. This is why I actually thought she would win. I thought the American people were going to be like, okay, well, at least, you know, we're progressing. They weren't going to be excited about it, but I thought they'd pull it out. On the other hand, I'm far away now from where I was. It keeps going down. People are saying, no, just give a chance to something different. And that's why I say it's not economic. It's cultural, spiritual. It's a Hegelian type movement. It's going in this direction.
It's related to what people call neoliberalism.
It's related.
Not in a strictly economic sense. The worldview you are referring to is related, as some people have analyzed, to this notion of, as individuals, we can work it out by competing with each other in the market.
Yeah.
Right? So it's an economic view, but turned into a kind of a worldview.
Yeah.
As you said, right?
But that's why I think the worldview, the neoliberalism as a worldview, as an ideology, number one, when it's used at a lower rate, it means anything. When it's used at a high intellectual rate, though, it's ideologically abstract. You know, nobody's actually sitting there thinking neoliberalism. Like I said, I know working class people. They might think capitalism. I mean, that's one we always think, going back to the old Marxian definition. People aren't concerned with theory. They're not concerned with abstractions. We're concerned with theory. And it helps us predict kind of where things are going. But like I said, what you're actually seeing, it's a world view. Everything is just shaking. The American working class, all creeds, colors, is shaking. They're uncertain. They don't know what's going to go on. And they're scared. And like I said, all of a sudden you have the party that's supposed to be talking for them, talking down at them. And then they just get mad. Because all of a sudden that's what they go out there, oh, you know, keep your Christian nonsense away from us, this, that, and that. Oh, you're all racist and ignorant and stupid. Well, yeah, these people aren't going to vote for you. Nobody wants to get talked down to, even though, well, our policies are much better for you. How paternalistic is that? That's the same thing. That would be like, actually, the British done a better job of running this country than these guys have. Well, would you vote for them? No. You wouldn't say, come back and rule us. No, it's stupid.
Definitely more stable.
That's what I said. We're not going to invite the Queen back. And that's why I said, even with, like, Castro's another good example. He didn't do much objectively, but he gave the people their right. And he talked to them like he was one of them. He didn't go put himself in palatial estates. They saved it, like Forbes, like he had $900 million he owned this, that. I don't believe that for one second. Number one, what's he spending it on? He didn't have a Ferrari. He walked around in fatigues all the time and a tracksuit. Yeah, he wasn't, so I don't think he had that kind of money. But that's the way. Castro was in with the people. He talked to them. He related to them. And he helped them. Very small, incremental steps. I mean, Cuba's a poor country. They didn't take advantage of what they should have done. But people were with him because he was with them. Whereas now, we have, this is again, throughout the West, we have this very technocratic style of rule. European Union is seeing it too. We want rule by the technocrats. Hillary is kind of a technocrat. And that's why I said, people are not in touch with theory. You can't reach out, you can't grab on to theory. You can grab on to nationalism. You can grab on to populism. This is the climate we're going to be facing.
How do you think that there's clear election results, there's a clear rupture in the American society?
There's been a rupture for a long time.
All right. Along class line as well as the parts of the center.
Both, yeah.
Right.
Actually, this has been going on for a long time. Actually, it was John Edwards years ago talked about the two Americas. And John Edwards ended up, he had some very big scandals and really destroyed his career in the end. But he was always right about that. He was right that there were two Americas. That's why I said, this is not something we haven't seen before. And actually, though, this is 2004. John Kerry, very centrist, very technocratic, Democrat, decent record, very good, middle-of-the-road guy, lost. We keep losing. And then we said, he doesn't appeal. Working-class voters, lost Ohio, doesn't appeal. But then actually what goes back, actually what happens is a lot of political scientists go and they tell you, no, the working class is actually for Americans, just by redefining the working class. We have statistics that say this. So right now, this is why I said, I've seen this for years. Now all the Democrats were looking and were saying, okay, now we got to reach out, we got to reach across the aisle, reach out to these different people. In about 6 months, we'll forget all that. This is where I work. Actually, my county is very much like that. Because we have a university there, so we have very professional, very liberal people. They're all around there talking, preaching to the choir, preaching to the converted, and having all these sessions about abstractions and great theories and how are we going to do this? We should get away with guns and this and that. And that's it. It's preaching to the converted. You're not getting anything done. Nobody's even talking to other people. This is one thing I always try to push people. You need to be able to speak their language. I grew up with it, so I'm a class migrant, as they say. So I'm not optimistic that we will fix it.
because like I said, it's something we've done for years now. And actually there's too much complacency that the demographics will eventually shift in our favor. Eventually, you know, white folks are gonna get outnumbered. But like I said, that's very stupid because it just seems Hispanics are gonna go like white people.
It reflects the whole consciousness of American working class in that sense.
Yeah, like I said, nobody believed all the promises that he was going to do. They just said, they're looking at, the voter is a rational animal when it comes down to it. There are people now, there are crazies on every side, but the voters are basically rational animals. They said, we're going to go down regardless. Even though technically, once again, this is where we got to be careful as political scientists. Even though our economy is growing, everything's trending up, the country's getting better, 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 the people aren't feeling it. So that's why I said, to them, they looked at this election and they sat there and they said, we're going to keep going downhill anyway. Hillary's not going to substantially shake anything up and change anything. We'll continue to grow, the country will do good, but I'm not doing good. And then you have Trump that was sitting there and it was like, this guy's a buffoon. But, you know, hey, he's speaking a few things in my language. Because, like, I'm going to slap tariffs on Chinese steel. Put guys back to work. Yeah. Probably not going to do it. But would you take the chance if you're a steel worker? You sit there and you just say, okay, yeah, I'll throw it up. See, I'm rolling the dice. 4 years from now, if you don't do what I like, I'll throw him out too. Then the next guy comes in, or gal. So, I mean, really, it was a rational choice. They were seeing, they're seeing a trend, a cultural trend, a historical process, if you will, on the Marxian side, that is leading in a direction they don't like. So, I mean, they're going to kick against it.
Yeah, I have a very vulgar saying, but I'm going to use it anyway. They say, if you're going to eat a shit sandwich, pick the one with the most bread. Alright, that's fine.
But actually, this is the thing. I would say that if this had caught us out of nowhere, it did not catch us out of nowhere. And actually, I said we build two classes on this. This is what's actually very, very interesting about the Democratic Party. Like I was saying, most of the people in leadership positions are bourgeois, middle-class, white people. And where do they come from? Universities. This is the issue. Because actually, in this is something I've seen. These kids will come out and they're in the university and they're all on fire. Social justice, this, that, and the other. So they're out there, they protest sweatshops. They'll come out and knock doors with union members, us poor working class people. They'll come out and talk to us and we're all friends and everything. But they don't like us. They act like they love the working class, but they don't even like us. The thing is, when they go back to the university, they're not hanging out with working class people. They're hanging out with other social justice, liberal, bourgeois, middle class people. So even when they get some exposure to us, what you get is you have a bourgeois class fetishizing the proletarians, the working class. They're fetishized. We love them. We're standing up for your rights. We're helping you. But like I said, I don't want to go to your parties. I don't want you in my house. I don't want you living on my street, but I love you. I want to pick you up. I want to elevate you. Viva la revolución! Yeah, great. It's bullshit, is really what it is. It's a fetishization. And when they have experience with the working class, it's in university. But like I said, they actually are friends with other people in the same class. When they graduate college, they either go into private sector or they go into the government sector, where again, this is your cultural hegemony.
they're actually just around people that are doing the same thing. So you actually have a party elite that is all of this culture. Very bourgeoisie, middle class, right there. Even though they have some experience, I was an activist when I was in school. Their entire trajectory after that has taken them away from the people they're representing. That's how you got your two Americas, is that actually. And so the reason the Democratic Party and the Hillary campaign didn't see it is because of that class. A few outliers like us, we were kicking against it a long time. But it's actually, it's a self-reinforcing bubble. They actually didn't get caught in it.
But then they would have heard if they listened carefully to what Bernie Sanders was bringing into the debate, right?
To an extent, on the economic side. Mm-hmm. Like I said, Bernie Sanders' problem was he didn't diversify his message. He just said there are big banks, Wall Street, big banks, Wall Street, big banks, Wall Street.
He was talking about the minimum wage and working class conditions.
Yeah, but he wasn't going past it. He was just sitting here. He was throwing up, like I said, it wasn't even, Jesse Jackson at least was inspired. Bernie was kind of like a crotchety old man, just screaming about stuff. You know, and I like the man that he brought this along. Also, he didn't appeal to the nationalist side. This is another thing we have a big problem with in the left, is people have become so post-materialist. There's one they hate. But actually, the biggest critics of America are Americans. All they do is run down their country all the time. It's the same damn thing. When you're sitting there and it's like, if you're a patriot, like a regular working class guy, like I said, a lot of these guys are military men, and you actually like America, and then all you get is, America is evil, America does all this horrible stuff, Americans are all racist, sexist. You get tired of that. Nobody wants to tear their own country down. You know, we can have an honest appraisal of it, and we realize we got things wrong, but nobody wants to hear 24 hours a day all the time America's
the worst place. America has been evil, right, in the world, for a long time.
America had to do what it had to do. Actually, America, this is an interesting part of the phenomenon too, that I don't know if it's going to work out this way or not. But one thing Trump really appealed to was the American isolationist streak. And this is something that's very historical for us. Unlike Britain, we are not a good imperial power because we don't like it. And my grandmother addresses packages to us. Now, we've been here almost 3 years. You know what she writes? Sir Linka. The average American does not care about Sri Lanka, Sri Lanka, India, or anywhere else in the world. We're not really that interested in you. This is our historical growth has been between two oceans where we were getting away from all that. We don't want to get involved in your nonsense anywhere in the world. That's fine. People here are ignorant of the rest of the world. If you're in your own country, it's great. What happened was, this again goes back to the Second World War. All of a sudden, we were the only guys left standing. Us and the Soviets were really in the downward end. But we were it. So who's going to take over the world order? Who's going to create a world order? It was between us and the Soviets. And the Soviets had been beaten badly. You know, just on demographics and everything, because they got beat up in the World War I, they got beat up in the Bolshevik Revolution, then they got 25 million people in World War II. They were starting behind that. Our great triumph in the Cold War really wasn't that great a triumph when we started way ahead of everyone. But so this was the world order that we had to inherit. Somebody has to be the hegemon. That became us and the Soviets for a while. Then it became us. So, but America's never wanted this responsibility. That's the thing. The American policymakers, the elites and the politicians, of course, we recognize the responsibility, we have to do it. And fact is, I've often told people, a lot of people have been playing this America go home, Yankee go home, Yankee go home card for years. I said, be careful what you wish for, we might. Because then you'll see a lot of instability in the world. But yeah, that's an American sentiment that's always been very isolationist, that stay out of it, we don't care. And actually, this is part of the thing that goes on. This is another thing that we see. More so than the inequality with these astronomical figures of billionaires, people get mad about foreign hate. Why the hell are we giving money to Egypt? Why the hell are we giving money to Congo, Nigeria, Sri Lanka? What the hell? Why don't we spend that money here for our own people? This is what you hear all the time. Why are we helping? Why do we care? This is a very American attitude. And Trump went with that. I don't think his policy guys are going to let him just pull away from the world. But the American people, part of the reason they voted for him was this pull back in, the hell with it. And then it's like we're out there are promoting democracy. We actually don't care if you have democracy or not. As long as you leave us alone. That's the American attitude. No, they don't care. No, they don't care. It's just, it's very simple. Actually, your average American person does not care.
I don't know about the looting, the resources from outside the world, all this other stuff. See?
You, yeah, but
so
you
that's how you'll be like, you're feeding these people. You should understand that.
Yeah. I don't know. We have big trade problems and things. Then you also have, because we subsidize a lot of food, but that's not to be generous. That's to protect our farmers, which Europe does that too, which is actually a bad, it's a bad trade policy, but if you say that's a bad trade policy, then technically you're being neoliberal, you're being a globalizer. We should have free trade. You guys should have competitive advantage in agriculture. So that's why I said, with the pseudo-Marxists, it's like, okay, which way do you want to have it? Don't be ideological with me, because there is no ideological way. Because sometimes you want a little free market, sometimes you want a little protection. And this is the problem.
I feel, when I listen to your, the last part of your response to this, I feel that, you know, so far as we have this American Supreme Court complex, I think having someone like Donald Trump as a president is kind of surprising to me.
But the American superiority complex is something you people have. Like I said, actually nobody in America really cares about it. Like, we don't care what you think at all.
That's what Trump said, no, we will become a nation that's greater in the world than it was before. I mean,
yeah, but he was talking mostly on domestic things.
And I don't know that you were talking about this cultural factor. I was thinking about it and trying to comprehend. I mean, in simple terms, like, if the Americans are, or the working class more and more into, you know, sort of, you know, safeguarding their culture, their religious values, their morals and traditions. I mean, this guy Trump, I mean, I don't know whether, I mean, it was proven that he said, you know, I would like to grab women by the pussy. And he's married 3 times. And he's married to a woman in the same age of his daughter, right, more or less, a young person. And then, when you think of Hillary Clinton, you know, when the Monica Lewinsky scandal came up, she behaved like a very traditional conservative woman. She didn't raise a family. Yes.
Yeah.
So where do you draw the line then? And the other thing, I think that, I mean, as Kumudu and Sumit was trying to say, I mean, Trump was able to play two cards very well: illegal immigrants and the Muslim factor, which are the biggest fears of the American people today. And it has a very economic, you know, factor in that, I think, because maybe he didn't mean actually building a physical wall, but what he was saying is, I would not allow anyone to come into America and take your jobs.
Yeah.
So he's giving an assurance, it's economic.
Yeah, that
and also saying that, you know, I'm going to, you know, sort of prevent you from getting physically harmed, right? So he was giving this assurance that I'm going to build America economically very great. He wasn't talking about culture or tradition or anything at all.
No,
and he was like calling women hombre and all other things. People didn't mind that, because basically, as you said, the uneducated or the ignorant or the working class, whatever you would name or label, this is what they wanted.
Actually, what you get, though, too, again, now you're discounting the rationality of the voter, because now the Republican, this is a big thing. Like, evangelical Christians turned out like 81%. Actually, Trump won all religious groups except Jewish groups. So, I mean, what we're looking at on that, but it's not because Trump is considered a paragon of virtue. But see, that's the thing. Religious people will vote for someone, the party. Actually, his vice presidential nominee is a very conservative Catholic. So, with a lot of evangelical influence. So they're saying now, who's going to appoint, like I said, especially for religious voters, values voters, the Supreme Court was the issue. And Hillary Clinton was going to appoint, in their minds anyway, very liberal, very left-wing justices that were going to strengthen abortion, homosexuality, things like that. So the religious people don't like Trump as a person, but they were going to hold their nose and vote their interests. That was the thing they were worried about on that. Yeah, but actually, there was a lot of movements, if you read the evangelical Christian things, what they were talking about. They were very conflicted about having to vote for this man. But they pulled the lever anyway. They made a rational choice on that. But yet nobody was saying Trump's a great guy. Immigration is, to a great extent, an economic issue. Because it's seen as depressing wages, seen as taking jobs. So, I mean, that's part of it. But another reason is, this immigration problem did not come out of nowhere. More so than a great fear of economic things was actually this issue. George W. Bush tried to take it up in 2000. When he was young. Then we got distracted with 9/11 stuff. Mm-hmm. Then the Senate and everybody, they were trying to pass immigration reform in 2005, 2006, I believe. So this had been an issue. We're going to secure the borders. And now we have to worry about terrorism, we have to worry about drugs coming over, and the illegal immigrants, economic pressures. People don't like it, but they've been saying for 10 years, at least, this has been on the burner. We're going to solve this immigration problem. We're going to pass either an amnesty, we're going to do something. It wasn't done.
Yeah, it's because I think most of the people, especially the Mexicans, they come to America to do the menial type of jobs.
Yeah. And
they
actually,
do the jobs that Americans don't want to do, even the American working class.
Well, and actually,
that's why the state doesn't want to, do not want to be.
Well, and the big business influences them
because
big business hires them.
Because they will be in trouble.
Yeah, but I'm saying the reason is it wasn't like all of a sudden 2016 people became afraid of ignorance and or immigrants and it was on fear. This is actually an issue that they've been saying and it's been knocked aside and finally one guy came out. Like I said, not on fear, but actually said, I'm going to do something.
Yeah, that's why he played on these cards.
Yeah. The Muslim thing I don't think is actually that. Again, it's a rather minor thing. Actually, American elections aren't really decided on foreign policy because, like I said, most don't care. The fact that he was going to take a harder line appealed to people, but American elections are almost, unless there's an actual war going on, they're almost always decided on domestic issues. I said foreign policy is such a technocratic area anymore. But that's why I said all we're doing now, and this is an interesting parallel, actually. Because you look like when we had more of a world policeman role and when the Cold War was going on, the reason we were able to do so much is we had the Soviets as rivals. So the American people, we did a lot of things like with containment, Korea, Vietnam, we were in these places to contain the expansion, this, that, and the other, and they were very unpopular moves. People didn't like it. There were protests all the time, people hated it, but they went and they took it. Because the obstacle, we had the Russians there. So there was a reason. We have to keep this contained. They have nuclear weapons. The whole world could end, da da da. So we were willing to lose 60,000 people in Vietnam to contain people. Now, the order hasn't changed. The world order has not changed at all. This international liberal order has not changed at all. But now the Soviets aren't there. Now all of a sudden America goes to Iraq. Iraq compared to like Vietnam is nothing. We lost a few thousand people. But we don't want it. We don't want anything to do it. Because now there's no Soviet Union. Now we want even less of it. So that's why I said this whole idea that we're going to go build democracy, we don't care. That's what you have people. Bring Saddam back. Doesn't matter. Bring him back from the dead. Put him back in charge. We don't care. Do whatever you want. So international affairs has always been very technocratically managed. Foreign policy is
an idea of containment, stuff like this. It doesn't really relate to the voter unless their kids are getting sent home in boxes. Then they get real upset about it. And now, more so than ever, we have very little tolerance for it. So to a great extent, I say this isolationist thing played a bigger part than even the immigrants or the Muslims. And actually, it's something surprisingly well amongst people that you wouldn't think you did. And it's for that reason. You have to trust the rationality of the voter to be able to sort the wheat from the chaff. They know when they're getting lied to, so they look for what